Good morning. Thank you so much for coming out. My name is Christy Wilkinson. I'm the vice president of the Highland Park Neighborhood Association. We are really lucky to have a nice little clustering of beautiful neighborhoods around us, and I'm very grateful for the help from neighbors in Orchard Knob and Ridgedale and Glenwood for making this happen. I'm also very grateful to all of the candidates who came out this morning in the rain on the first Saturday of early voting. Very impressive. So let's give them a round of applause. And it looks like we're missing a couple of people, so I'm assuming that they're just running late. This is my lovely moderator. This is Marvine Noel. She is the president of the Orchard Knob Neighborhood Association. Hopefully, people walking in were able to grab a card on which you will be able to write your question and who it's to. If you don't have a card, raise your hand and someone will try to rush one over to you. Please write on the top part of that back page who your question is directed at. We have District 9 City Council candidates here, District 8 City Council candidates here, and the mayoral candidates in the back. Or you can direct your question at every candidate. And then each candidate will have a minute and 30 seconds to answer the questions. And I'll be keeping time. So I'm going to give it to Marvine to take over. And thanks again for coming.
Good morning. Once again, thank you all for coming out on a rainy Saturday. And once again, thanks to the panel that is here for your time. Like she said, you have a minute and a half to respond to the question that is given to you. She will time you and let you know, hold the cards up, give you 30 seconds or whatever you have left. I will read the questions, and if they have been directed to an individual, then I will let you know who you are. If it's to the panel as a whole, I will also state that. So if we are ready.
We'll start with the introduction.
With the introduction.
We'll have Pat go first.
Okay. 3 minutes, correct?
Yeah.
3 minute introduction to tell us about yourself.
All right, well, I'm not sure if I can pontificate for 3 minutes, but I'll do my best. First, I would like to say thanks to everybody for showing up this morning and everybody for helping organize this event. My name is Pat Benson Jr. and I'm running for Chattanooga City Council because District 9 is in a state of crisis. We've had 22 homicides in 4 years. We have a poverty rate near 40%. And we have over 300 abandoned homes in the Eastdale neighborhood alone. This isn't your normal city election. This is a time for soul searching for us as a community. Are we okay with the status quo? Or do we want change? And if you want change, then you need to vote Pat Benson Jr. on March 7th. I've put forth my 9-point plan for District 9 recovery. It targets crime and safety, education training, public health, and just this week, I put out the parameters for a universal pre-K expansion so every child in the city of Chattanooga can get opportunity to go to pre-K education. Now, you're gonna hear a lot of talk today, a lot of campaign promises, and I'll go ahead and tell you, I'm not the best speaker, maybe not even the smartest, but I can't be outworked. I have a backbone made of steel, and I wear my heart on my sleeve. You're always going to know where I'm coming from. I look forward to this forum today and expanding upon these ideas. And thanks again for everybody for showing up.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Demetrius Coonrod, the People's Candidate for City Council for District 9. I was born and raised in Chattanooga in District 9. I caused much disruption in District 9, and it's part of my motivation for why I'm coming back to the district to claim District 9. And so I was a product of my environment, single-parent home, and I, too, am a single parent now. Both of my parents were addicted to drugs. We kind of bounced around throughout the community, and, you know, I had someone to intervene that was very important in orchestrating my life, and that was my grandmother to get me back on the right path. I am a restored, convicted felon, and I stand before you as a phoenix rising. It's too many people that's in our district that have the same exact story, and I wear those shoes of the 9,000 people in my district. It's time for us to make a change in our community. Education is simply has failed us. We've seen the reports to where we can't even build affordable housing but due to the high number of concentrated poverty. So just think about what that does to our school system and our kids and the learning environment. So it's time for us to most definitely make a change. The foundation has already been poured for District 9, but allow me to continue to be your general contractor. Let's move this thing forward. Let's get the needs addressed that's in our community that's affecting our district as a whole. I ask for you to vote for Demetrius Coonrod.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Truly, I thank those who organized this event for the opportunity to speak to the different neighborhoods and communities. Now, I am a native Chattanoogan. I've lived in the district for 44 years. Unlike some of my opponents who may have lived here 2 years. And I think, in addition to that, I want to share with you, my wife and I have been together for 51 years. So yes, she needs a hand. Yeah, she needs a hand for putting up with me for 51 years. Now, we've been blessed with four children. And again, being blessed, all four of them have finished college. Three at UTC, and we say about our youngest daughter that she went astray. She went to UTK. And I do have my three daughters and my son-in-law, who's from the island, with us here today. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm of the belief that a representative should be from among the people they want to serve. And there's a tendency, I guess it's bothering me, that a person would be insensitive and not show respect for our community by putting out a flyer with a child on it. Now, if I did something like that, I'd be called, what is that term? Playing a race car, okay? So I have a problem with that. But I want to talk to you about the fact that I have relationships at City Hall. I have relationships with the staff. And, you know, we talk about change. Well, we're getting a grocery store in East Chattanooga. We have some new sidewalks in the Glass Street area. We have an apartment complex that has a pilot in the Ridgedale community. We've had improvements on the Wilcox Tunnel. We're going to get more. Ban the Box affords a greater opportunity for second chances for people. A disparity study that documents what the shortcomings are in the way we do business here in the city of Chattanooga. I was on the team that assisted in keeping the only bank in East Chattanooga there. So I'm saying to you, these are facts that you can check out. Anything I say. And one other thing, ladies and gentlemen, I think to show my commitment to this community and wanting to be a role model for our young people, I can say to you emphatically, I do not drink, I do not smoke, I have never bought, sold, or used illegal drugs. So I think I have the discipline needed to carry this job further.
Good morning, my name is John Kearns. I am a resident here in Highland Park. I am a business owner here in Highland Park. In autumn of last year, I decided to seek the District 9 City Council seat because too many of our neighborhoods here in Chattanooga's inner city are still on the outside of Chattanooga's renewal. Now, I believe that that's reversible, but we need a new leader carrying the message for our neighborhoods and communities on City Council. If you look back at Chattanooga's history, you'll find that when we're all pulling in the same direction, we tend to accomplish big things. It's been a long time since our city has had a cohesive vision for its future, and it's time to change that because it is time that our city turn its attention inward into the inner city. It's in Chattanooga's inner city where we see our highest concentrations of poverty. It's also where we see our highest concentrations of violent crime. It is no coincidence that those two things occur in the same place. It's going to take prioritizing the communities of District 9 for recruiting employers, for job training, for building affordable housing if we're going to reverse those trends. I bring a measure of experience to this race on doing those exact things. A lot of folks are going to talk to you today about creating jobs in our district. I'm the only one that's done it. I started my company 7 years ago here in Chattanooga, started at the Business Development Center, and relocated it to Macaulay Avenue here in District 9. And in that time, we've been able to create over 80 jobs for residents in Chattanooga. That measure of experience, of opportunity creating experience, budgeting experience, and alliance building experience is what we need at this moment in District 9. Once again, my name is John Kearns, and I would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. All right. Hello, my name is Anthony Bird. I'm a Chattanooga native, born and raised here in Chattanooga. I've worked at criminal court for over 22 years, seeing the displacement and unjust things that go on in our city for so long. That's one of the reasons why I decided to run. As a regular person like yourself, I always wonder, who can I hold accountable for my community falling? Who can I hold accountable for my kids going to failing schools? And I realized that during this election, you're going to hear a lot of things about how my candidates haven't done A, B, and C, or how maybe I haven't done this or that. But the thing about it is who wants to serve? As a kid, I was told to serve my community, to serve people. And my mom always told me that made God proud. That made Jesus feel good when you serve. So who's serving you right now? Who's being held accountable for the things that are going on in your neighborhood? Who's at your doorstep? Who's calling you on the phone to find out what's going on in your community? Don't just take what's going on right now because I want to be elected, so I'm going to call you. I'm going to let you know that I'm with you. Look what happens 4 years ago after the election, after you voted different people into office. What happened then? Did you get the phone calls? Did you get anyone knocking at your door? Did you hear anything? And that's what made me run, because no one was being held accountable for what was going on in my neighborhood, and no one was calling after I voted in 2013. So I'm running now to make change. I'm running now to finish the last leg of the race, because we have no one in line to take the torch. We have no one in line to say, hey, come on, I need to finish this last leg of this race. Who's there? No one. So I want to be in line, and I want to finish that last leg of the race, and I want to be there for my community and show that, hey, we can take Chattanooga to the next level, and we can create better jobs, better housing, and better communication amongst each other and take it to City Hall. Thank you so much.
Good morning. Good morning. This is a special occasion in a community where candidates can come and present themselves to you, and I'm humbled by the event that is sponsored here and the ones that we've had throughout our community. This has been really an enlightening period for the city of Chattanooga, and I take it very serious that we're having these events. This has been the best year in a long time where communities throughout the community have had these forums, and I appreciate you for it and for coming together as a large four-block neighborhoods to do this, and congratulations for that. First of all, let me tell you that my name is Moses Freeman. I'm the councilman for District 8. Within District 8, there are parts of 12 to 13 neighborhoods that comprise this neighborhood, and they run all the way from Interstate 24 over here all the way up to Wilder Street on the other end of the district, and they include neighborhoods like Park City, Avondale on the other end of it, east parts of East Chattanooga on the opposite end, Boyce Station as a neighborhood, and in between parts of Highland Park over on Duncan Avenue and parts of Highland Park over here, including the section over here behind Bennett Street all the way to Main Street, and then they include Orchard Knob and a certain section of Glenwood neighborhood, and then down on Main Street, certain sections in the Main Street area, and then Bushtown, and then just Avondale, and just whole sections of the community, and I get to interact with all of those people. Clifton Hills is another section that I have responsibilities for, and I go to almost all of those meetings, and I did mention Lincoln Park too as well, as another one of the neighborhoods, and I probably left out one or two others. And they have neighborhood meetings, and all of those neighborhood meetings is where you go and get the flavor of what the neighborhood associations are doing. We try to operate through neighborhood associations so we can empower groups of people like neighborhood associations to represent the district, if you will, or their sections of the community. And I have done a great job of that. And as a result of listening to the people, we've gotten things done, such as saving SunTrust Bank on 3rd Street, which was about to close, and had notified all of the voters and members of those communities that they were going to close. They had sent out letters. Now that bank is still opening and thriving. We'd also heard the flavor that they needed a new recreation center, one that was over 70 years old, they were still operating in. And now, thanks to the mayor and our hard work, we're getting a new recreation center over there. We've gotten roads paved in that neighborhood, and we're getting other things because we listen to the voters. We go to their meetings. We hear them. We answer every call. Every complaint, there's not a person in that district who has called my office, called me on my cell phone, that hadn't had a response from me, who hadn't seen me come out and look at that problem face-to-face and gotten an answer or a response. We work to satisfy the issues that people face on a day-to-day basis. And we also work to solve the global problems, working on crimes solutions and other solutions and housing problems. Thank you very much for listening, and we'll be glad to answer your questions as time goes on. Thank you.
Good morning. On Petu Washte and buenos dias a todos los que hablan español aquí. My name is Tom Kunish. I live over there across Main Street over in Ferger Place. We moved there, my wife and I, and now five kids moved there 18 years ago when Main Street was full of prostitution and there were crack houses and the neighborhood was generally falling down. And we have seen it increase and blossom over the past 10, 15 years. It's been beautiful. My daughters, I have four daughters, one's a graduate, two of them are graduates of Eastside Elementary down here. Another one goes there currently. One goes to CGLA here, and next year we have one going to Eastside Elementary. So I'm invested in this game. I got skin in this game probably more than anybody else up here. My kids go to these schools. I'm a Native American activist. My family is Standing Rock Lakota, from North and South Dakota, Standing Rock Reservation. I'm from Minnesota. I moved here 27 years ago, and since then I've been an activist involved in the Moccasin Bend issue. Some of you may remember that, when the city and county jointly owned that property out there, 956 acres, and they wanted to put a Chattanooga State or the zoo or industry out there, and we in the Chattanooga Intertribal Association saved that land. You may remember Chief Makanuga, the racist mascot at UTC, and how the Chattanooga Intertribal Association with the Black Student Association changed that mascot. Currently, I'm involved with the Lincoln Park and Citico issue, where the city has promised to give Lincoln Park to the Lincoln Park Neighborhood Association, and we want to make Lincoln Park an historic district, like Ferger Place, like Battery Place, like Fort Wood, to make it the first African-American historic district in the city. Memphis has it, Nashville has them, Memphis has them, I should say. Chattanooga has nothing. This brings up the question of the disparity study that has been studied in 2015 and 2016, and still, Chattanooga does not know how bad its disparity is when we have a population of at least 36% African American, and African Americans are getting less than 5% of the contracts. Women are getting less than 5% of the contracts and make up 30% of the population. We need that disparity study, and people up here have voted against the disparity study, and it's been 2 years now, and still nothing has been done about it. I'm Tom Kunish. I want to be elected to the City Council to make sure that the disparity study gets passed, that Lincoln Park gets passed, and that Avondale Recreation Center has African-American architects and builders in it. Thank you.
Well, good morning. I'm Andy Burke, and I wanted to distinguish myself from the incredible people that you see up here, so I wore jeans today. Just to make sure that everybody knew I was a little different than everybody else. Let me start by saying a couple of things. Number one is, I'm happy to be here, particularly because, as many of y'all know, because you see me at these events, this is where my family came when they came to this country. They settled at the corner of Highland Park and Main Street. And then when my granddad moved out of my great-grandfather's house, he moved into Glenwood, which was where my dad was raised, and my dad likes to say that he went to school in the parking lot of Memorial, because the old Glenwood Elementary was where he went. And I know Evelina lives over there now, and she's nodding her head because she gets to talk to my dad about it a fair amount. Also want to just say, to take away from my race for just a minute, it's incredible to see people standing up and asking for your vote and arguing on behalf of their neighborhoods and the people that they want to serve. It's tough. I've been doing this now for a little while. It's tough to do what these candidates are doing, and I appreciate them, just like I appreciate y'all for being out here this morning. Now, we've made a lot of progress in our city over the last few years. The zip code that we're standing in right now, the unemployment rate is down in this zip code 58%. Alton Park, 3741, no. The unemployment rate is down there 36%. Nobody's saying that that's enough. Nobody's saying that we should proclaim victory and stop working. But the way that you get there is through the hard work that brings people together and figures out how you continue to make those steps that pull our city forward and to make sure that everybody participates. We've had the third highest wage growth in the country for a mid-sized city. That's fantastic, because as people get more money, what do? They spend it, and that creates a virtuous cycle with more jobs. And the places that we're seeing investments in neighborhoods all around us. But just as you know, when everybody is making, when many people are making more money and you see lots of investment, if you're not one of those people whose income's going up, then you feel left out of the rising tide. And so part of what we have to do over the course of the next few years is to figure out how we make sure that more people are included in our growing prosperity and that we have a fairer city and economy. So you've been hearing us talk a little bit, hearing me talk a little bit about how the city is going to move further into workforce development, something that previously has been left only to the county and the state. And we've been doing a lot of different initiatives to link up jobs to workforce, and we have to expand that through a new Office of Workforce Development. We also have to start by strengthening families at the earliest levels and by ensuring that kids get off to the right track so that they don't move into those places that we see too often in our city. And that means investing in early learning with a new Office of Early Learning, investments in scholarships for families and kids to get up on the right track, baby university, and so on. The more investments that we make at this early stage, the better off our city is. And then finally, we have to make sure that we're doing those things on public safety that are going to lead to real results. You know, we've seen property crime at historic levels. I remember when I came to these neighborhoods 4 years ago, hearing a lot about property crime. We don't hear that today because we're at historic lows. A violent crime down more than 10%. That's fantastic, but we still see far too many guns on the street, and the actions that we're taking today are to push and make sure that we focus on guns and making our city a safer place.
Good morning. I'm David Crockett, and I'm running for the mayor of the city of Chattanooga. I was first in Highland Park and in Glenwood in 1975, working with a nascent, just a beginning neighborhood association. I had become president of the largest neighborhood association in the city, 15 subdivisions in Hickson, had done the first visioning of any neighborhood or anything in the city, had created the most in-depth plan for environment, economy. We had planned the zoning of every lot, and then we wanted to spread that citywide. So UTC facilitated a meeting, and I met with a man named John Holmes, for president of Glenwood Neighborhood Association. We brought John and many of his neighbors to Hickson to meet with our neighborhood association. We brought many of our neighbors to Glenwood to meet with their neighborhood association. We did the same thing with Tommy Ashford and Murtis Watson in South Chattanooga. And in 1976, I got in a flat bottom boat with someone from TBA and with a chainsaw, and we went up Chattanooga Creek, and taking water samples and land samples, we went all the way from the bridge on Hooker Road all the way to Chattanooga Creek's nexus with the Tennessee River. I'm not a stranger to working in the inner city. I was chairman of the Inner City Task Force in the 1980s. I was elected to the council in 1990. I served three terms. I had, among the things I did, I initiated the getting the volunteer site procurement. I initiated the South Side. I spent a lot of time and got the idea of Chattanooga becoming the sustainable city adopted by every agency and government in Hamilton County. And what that means, and I'm wearing the pen, that means that with every decision, every dollar that you improve education, you improve the economy, you improve the environment, and you improve equity. And this is what I will do in my term of office. My business career was IBM, 25 years and the CEO of a software company. I know how to do it. And I raised $400 million to do major projects when I was a councilman. It takes money to do the Lord's work, as an old rabbi said. And I know how to raise it. And we will renew these communities at scale. Thank you very much. I ask for your vote.
Thank you so much for the candidates here for your time and your response to your introduction. So now we will go ahead and go forward with the questions that we have received, and I will direct them to, if it's an individual, I will direct, if not, I will tell you all. This first question here is for any and all candidates. The question is, with the state legislature proposing bills that would determine, that would undermine marriage equality and anti-transgender bathroom bills similar to North Carolina, will you unequivocally stand with Chattanooga LGBT community as we defend and fight for our rights? This is for any and all candidates.
This is an issue that when I'm in office, I'm going to beat the partisans out of the city hall. No Democrats, no Republicans, no independent, no libertarians, no Tea Party, no nothing. This is the most political environment I've ever seen. This is a civic endeavor. And we will defend the rights of all Chattanoogans, and I will do that boldly. whoever you are, I'm on your side in Chattanooga. There's no question about that. I'll take on things this mayor won't take on. I'll take on things none of my other opponents will take on. I'll take on Republicans as I am now in the legislature who are trying to pass harmful legislation to Chattanooga. And I will take them on any issue. I'll take on Democrats. I'll take on Republicans. I stand for Chattanooga and all Chattanoogans.
Is this for me? Sure, I would. Yep. First of all, the Supreme Court has spoken. When it comes to gender and sexuality, we have to ensure equal rights for all. Bathroom bills are discrimination at its worst. Not only that, but it would alienate our state from the rest of our country. It would motivate other states to discontinue doing business with us. So yes, I stand with those who stand for equal rights for all Chattanoogans.
The short answer is yes. And I can back that up. Those of you who may be aware, it was a very contentious vote in City Council in regards to benefits for partners. I was one of those five who affirmatively on that. I'm not telling you what I may do. I'm telling you what I did. And again, I'm appalled that one of my opponents, who has a history and a track record of not voting in a manner that is indicative of supporting people of all gender, vote. We say this is nonpartisan. I'm Democrat. When you vote Republican and you tell the people that you're an independent, if you can't believe him now, how are you going to believe him going forward? Thank you.
I don't need the mic for this. I'll just shout it out.
Well, wait a minute. Hold up. It's my turn. I'm going to need y'all to wait now. I got something to say. You know I respect you, Moses, but it's my round right now. Okay. I need you to start my time over, please. Okay, so now, thank you. Now that I have your attention, I most definitely will support this. And it was a difficult decision going on when the current councilman was advocating for that. And I was a member from the community voicing my concerns on the front line for that as well. It's no different from the fight that African American have to go through. It's no different from the immigrants. It's still the same. And we're a city that often says we believe in equality. So why not be supportive? I have family and friends, my closest friends, people that served in the military. You know, this is their lifestyle. We do not have the right to say how somebody should live their life. That's not up to us to do. But it's up to us as citizens to make sure we're protecting and fighting for those same equal rights. It's not just a matter of what you feel that you are. The important thing is that they're humans. And we already have heard from people that's running for mayor that say don't even get them the mayor seat. They just want to do the duty of getting the railroad, the system to Atlanta going in. So we have to take things into consideration. If you hadn't been on the front line advocating for years and years upon years, don't just stumble up to the scene and think you're going to be the rock to hold it down, because District 9, we holding this down.
Yes, this is an easy one for me. I 100% support the LGBT community. I'm it's a nonpartisan race, but I'm a lifelong Democrat. And I didn't just come up on this issue. I've marched with local Democrats and folks in that community. And we've got three strong Democrats in our race. And if you've picked up a Republican ballot 90% of the time, you've proven that a tax break is more important to you than supporting the rights of the LGBT community or communities of color or anybody else who needs our support, any other minorities. So that's all I have to say about that.
It's a serious matter when we can't support the rights of every American, regardless of their standing in our society, particularly the LGBT community. We need to stand for them. If you've ever been a minority, you should always know and be sensitive to any other minority group that is being mistreated. We know how it feels in our spirit and in our lives and in our bones, and therefore we could not resist the urge to stand with them at all costs. And that's how we feel about it in our hearts. And I stood with them at the beginning and championed the cause for equal benefits at the city, not because of a political stance, but because it is the right thing to do. And that's why we will continue to stand with them as a right thing to do. And we will insist that the city of Chattanooga stand with them as well. Thank you very much.
I also agree. I have a lot of friends that are part of the LGBT community, and they tell me all the time, Anthony, if you're not handsome in your area, you're not handsome in my area either. I don't want you. And so I think America is scared because they don't understand. We have to educate our kids. We have to educate our communities, because them not knowing the media make us germophobes, homophobes, racophobes. We have been trained by the media so strongly to fear each other that we don't love each other anymore. Everybody needs to have an understanding of who we are as a people, who we are as a race. And I think the more we come together and learn about each other, Chattanooga would definitely be a better place. So yes, I do support it.
I marched in the first gay pride march here in Chattanooga. I've been at the steps of City Hall pushing for equal rights, equal pay, and last month I performed a gay marriage up on the Cumberland Plateau. So I've been for it for a long time, but most importantly is what the introduction of that question was. And if the state government goes that way, now we don't have Stacey Canfield here to make crazier bills than ever, but when there's an issue in Chattanooga that's important that the city resist, and that is the $15 an hour minimum wage bill. And that the city has said, no, we're not going to go that way, because the state legislature says only the state can set that. But the city can make its own rules, and the city can pay its own workers $15 an hour. So yes, on gay rights, LGBTQ stuff, but more importantly, let us know that when we can and should resist the state legislature telling us when and when we can't do things.
So yes, I would stand with our LGBT community. In fact, as many of y'all know, I have stood with them over the course of many years, including while I was in the legislature voting on these very issues. And that's why I'm proud to have so many supporters in that community. And of course, while I was mayor, since I've been mayor, we brought forward the bill to change so that the city would give domestic partner benefits to our employees. But the one thing that I think that we all have to look at is today's politics is too divisive and too negative. And so across our country, including in Nashville and in Washington, we see people wanting to pit one person against another. And we have to resist that. We have to resist that at each and every turn. Since I've been mayor, we have the Mayor's Council for Women, which figures out how we bring together more people in our community to enhance and grow the opportunities for females all across our city. The Mayor's Youth Council, our Minority Business Task Force. Again, making sure that everybody is included, because if there's one thing that we know, we live in the century of talent, And the more that we grow and enhance what everybody can experience in our city, the stronger that we will be. And so as a goal, stripping down the barriers that each person faces so they can live the life of their choosing in the city is a pretty worthy place to start as Chattanoogans.
The next question is for all candidates. With gentrification being a concern, are there any plans to encourage diversity through housing, education, and employment opportunities?
So right now, Chattanooga is in the middle of a housing crisis. Half of the city is paying more than a third of their monthly income for their rent or for their mortgage payment. We have banks that have been proven not to loan money for home loans to black men and women. And we need a city council person who's going to stand up for the people who need a voice. And it doesn't stop at housing. It moves on to jobs and it moves on to education. Chattanooga has a history of institutional racism. And for too long, that's cut too many of us out of a chance of prosperity. And as your councilman, I'm always going to work for you. I don't have the experience or the know-how growing up as a black person. I don't know what it's like to be discriminated against, but I can listen to you and I can do my best to help get you some fairness and equality and equity in our district.
Sure, not a problem. The question is, with gentrification being a concern, are there any plans to encourage diversity through housing, education, and employment opportunities?
Mm-hmm. So, first of all, we have to kick this systemic barriers that's going on that's hindering people from economic mobility. And when we look around and we see communities that are thriving, for instance, the community we're having this forum in, so many people are not even allowed to come, can't even afford to live in here now. Love what Highland Park is doing, but when you look at the number of people who've been moved from this community based on what's happening in the community, sometimes growth is needed and the improvements are, but we want to make those improvements and keep the people in those same communities, not force them to move out because you can't afford it. And then we also need to have acceptance. We got to get rid of these redlining practices. The jobs, we got to move out of this who I know. I got a four-year degree in sociology and I still can't get a job in my field because I'm not a part of the who's who. So if I'm not a part of John Doe's staff and he didn't know my family, my grandmother, or my aunties, then I won't be able to get the job that's making a reasonable amount. We've seen the reports. HUD housing is not even funding for affordable housing because we have high concentrated numbers. So we have to at least zone things and neighborhoods based on socioeconomic status, mixed use buildings, you know, and bring a different look. We gotta have a new vision for our district. I wish I had more time. But.
It makes a difference if you want to represent a people that either you have become immersed in that culture or you need to be from that culture. And what I'm saying to you is that you have a greater appreciation of the disparities with one of those two concepts. Now, in regards to, well, we do use Highland Park as an example of what can be throughout the city now. I've been with Highland Park since 1990. I can tell you about the 419 drug houses, the prostitution. This we can also say this of Ridgedale, and the low housing values. But it took partnerships between the council person, the people who live in the community, police department, and government. It can be done throughout this city if we work together. And that's my concept, working together works. Another big part of this is employment. My Working Together Works Workforce Development and Readiness Program. We're not talking about something that I might do. I'm talking about something we're doing right now, is to assist persons who are underserved, who are underemployed or unemployed to become a part of the system, so to speak. And that, I think, would help to slow down gentrification within the communities if people can afford to be where they want to live. Thank you.
We have got to develop our economies within inner city Chattanooga. But as we do that, we have to ensure that any progress that we make doesn't also lead to displacement for the residents of these communities. And the number one way that we can do that is with intelligent investments in education. Think about this for a second. A child born today in Chattanooga has a great chance of living to see the 22nd century. Think about how much our city and our communities are going to change between now and the 22nd century. And then ask yourself this. The child that's born today, when she enrolls in school in 5 years, are our schools ready to prepare her for the rest of the 21st century? I'm afraid I know the answer to that question. And I think you do too. Now, the city doesn't own our school system. We have to acknowledge that. But we can make some intelligent investments. We can make investments in early childhood education so that we can set the stage for a lifetime of learning for every young Chattanoogan. But we also have to invest in post-secondary vocational credentialing for our residents in District 9. We have many of the pieces in place now in order to do that. Our city has an inventory of venues where we can host this training. We can create alliances with the state of Tennessee, with the county, with our trade unions to bring these training opportunities into the neighborhoods that need them the most. Thank you.
I was wondering a while back, how do you have revitalization without gentrification? And a lot of people don't understand how to do that. I think one of the main things is we got to teach people how to own their homes. We got to teach them how to handle their credit. We're not educating our people. My whole motto is invest in the people. If you invest in the people, you get your best return every time because you educate the people. You show the young men how to show up for a job interview. As city councilmen, it's not so many things that we can do, but us as a community, I'm supposed to take your views and your opinions to City Hall. And that's what I'm supposed to do. So if we talk more and understand that, listen, it's up to us as a community to educate our kids, to educate each other on homeownership, on your credit. Half the friends that I have a credit score under 400. How are you going to get a home when your credit score is under 400? How are you going to get anything? They don't have anywhere to go, nowhere to look. So their opportunities and information don't make it to their doorstep. Us as a community, we have to bring that information to them. And I think that will stop a lot of gentrification in our communities. Thank you.
Thank you. If that was for me. Listen, I'm a real laboratory of that whole concept, and I'll give it to you in a short span. I started out at the city as a neighborhood revitalization specialist, the head of the Department of Neighborhood Services, to organize neighborhood and to get them involved in revitalizing their own neighborhood, clean up, fix up, spruce up, and be proud of their neighborhood. And after I'd done that for a while, I went and became a physical revitalization specialist with the Community Impact Program at the Lyndhurst Foundation. And I worked on 5 neighborhoods, including Highland Park and Orchard Knob and Bushtown and several other neighborhoods to get them to focus on physical revitalization, fixing up better and doing more things to their neighborhoods and like. And after I've done that, I went out and became a developer and built some homes in one neighborhood, which was ML King. It was the first private profit-making development in a neighborhood in like 60 years to help a neighborhood get off the ground at revitalization within a neighborhood, trying to keep both race and income in balance. And then I became a city councilman to help work it by making sure that the right zoning was in place to make sure that the people who were there could stay there, and that we didn't get an opportunity to build large complexes which drove the property values way out of sight for the people who was in the single family house. and therefore they could stay within their property. All of that does work. You look at Orchard Knob, and you look at ML King, and you look at Bushtown, you'll find that those neighborhoods are in balance as far as gentrification is concerned. There's a mix of everything you want to see in neighborhoods, and they're working, but you have to keep working at it. And I was a laboratory at every level of making those things work, and I'm still working at it as a city councilman. Thank you.
The primary reason why my wife and I moved into Ferger Place, this area, is because it was diverse and because it was going through a revitalization and because it was getting gentrified. We have to make a distinction between organic gentrification, which is revitalization, people buying houses, flipping them one at a time, and corporate gentrification, which is shutting down whole neighborhoods. In this District 8 alone, we've had Harriet Tubman's homes closed, loss of 1,000 people there. We're looking at the close of East Lake Courts, another 1,000 people gone from this district, less diversity. We have the most diverse schools in this district, which is another reason why my wife and I moved here. We have East Side, which is 50% black, 45% Hispanic. We have CGLA, we have other great schools here that are diverse. So regarding the question, we have great gentrification happening, I believe, here in Highland Park. Ferger Place, where we don't have it, is where there are a lot of slumlords, and that's in Oak Park. Oak Park, right over here, otherwise known as Little Guatemala, which has Oak Park, I'm thinking Chicago. Oak Grove, I walk through there every day, no sidewalks, running ditches of water. And so this is one place that needs revitalization, needs some kind of gentrification. And I agree with others that one of the first things that we need to do is start encouraging home ownership. Thank you.
I did the first. I was chairman of the first visioning in Chattanooga in the 70s, where we did literally block by block, lot by lot, what the zoning was going to be and what the goals of that community were going to be for environment, for everything. And we had our actual goals on Chickamauga, North Chickamauga Creek, that were more stringent than the city or the state or the federal government. And we cleaned it up and made it the cleanest urban stream in the Southeast. You can do these things at a local level. I have the experience of doing that all in this district, and I've worked the last 15 years in cities in every state except Alaska and most Canadian provinces, working with people to solve these very problems. Now, if you come back now, I am bringing a plan that divides the city in Chattanooga into 400 micro units of 40 acres apiece. Within those, we're going to get down with a microscope. I don't believe in these Chamber of Commerce numbers that the mayor uses, that we had 8,000 jobs. What did you create? I want to know within that 40 acres who needs a house, who needs a job, who needs employment, help, who needs job training, and we're going to deliver it at that micro level.
We know the best places in our city are the ones that are diverse. Where are the places that you want to go? It's the places where you can see different kinds of art and listen to different kind of music and talk to different kinds of people. And those are the neighborhoods that you want to create. That's one of the reasons why people want to live in neighborhoods around here, is that those are the places that are enjoyable. Those are the places we want to come to. And so I think figuring out how we continue to do that is actually part of a real improvement for our city, because we have to preserve what we have, but also expand it into other places so that more neighborhoods are diverse. And And so we have to acknowledge a couple things. Number one is, if we're going to talk about housing, we should also acknowledge that the city gets a fraction of what it used to get from the federal government because of the cuts that were made over the last 6 years. Right? So when we talk about how we do housing, part of what the city has been doing is changing how it does affordable housing because we have less funding to do so. So we've preserved or built over 1,000 units, but we've had to be more strategic in how we do it. The second part is we have to acknowledge that part of what allows people to live where they want is to make sure that they have the incomes that are necessary to support that. The average person who lives in Chattanooga Housing Authority complex makes $9,000 a year. You don't have a lot of housing choices if you make $9,000 a year. And so by taking workforce development, getting it into our centers, changing where we do that, and allowing more people to access this, this is our way to raise incomes and actually to help neighborhoods as well.
Thank you, Mayor. If you will hold the mic, the next question is for you. Thank you. David Crockett has come out in full support of the high-speed rail connecting Chattanooga to Atlanta. Where does this fall on your priority list?
So we continued to have, so when I came into office, we had a high-speed rail project that had been going on for many years. We continue to have a project manager to do this. The total cost to do high-speed rail from here to Atlanta is $8.76 billion. So this doesn't happen without some interaction with the federal government, without the government doing this. And y'all may remember that President Obama, when he came in, tried to do some high-speed rail, and then that was eventually undone by the Congress. And so we continue to work on it, have project manager, and await word from the federal government that this is a priority to them and that we can see the funding that's necessary to get it done at $8.76 billion.
Could I respond to that, please? That's patently untrue. I started it. We competed for a $1 billion grant to build the first 40 miles to Cartersville. We got $5 million. We expanded eventually to $13 million to do the route and plan. We're competing against seven other cities. The financials of it work almost to the point of being a privately, commercially viable project. This mayor and his transportation department does not understand it. It was started to offload the Atlanta airport. We will move 4 to 6 million passengers a year back and forth between Chattanooga. We could not justify any kind of rail between Atlanta and Chattanooga without that. It will bring 150 flights to our airport. That helps Atlanta, and it transforms Chattanooga. We will have the jobs that our kids leave Chattanooga to get. That's why we started it. And I will make it happen.
Candidates, what are your thoughts about Chattanooga becoming a sanctuary city?
Will you repeat the question, Martin?
Sure. What are your thoughts about Chattanooga becoming a sanctuary city?
I'm absolutely in support of Chattanooga becoming a sanctuary city. America, you know, Statue of Liberty, that's what we're built on. We're built on a nation of immigrants. And if that makes our president mad, then I don't care. We gotta stick up for those who've immigrated here and they're looking for a better way of life. I'm not exactly sure what roles the city could play, but anything we can do to step up and help those who are less fortunate than us and are moving to America and pursuing the American dream, then Chattanooga will welcome them with open arms.
Now, I'm most definitely for the city of Chattanooga becoming a sanctuary city, but I do have some questions. Is that our country welcomes everybody to our country. They come to our country for a better way of life. But outside of that, when are we going to make it a better way of life for the people who reside in the country already, in our city of Chattanooga? So we need to take everything in consideration, and we need to make it possible for everybody, not just people coming from other countries. It's time for the people that are citizens now to start thriving as well. We need to get tax breaks as well. We need to have business opportunities. We're getting left behind in our own country. And that says a lot to me about where we're going in the direction. I do believe that everybody needs to have, you know, that ability to mobilize upwardly. Everybody needs to have the opportunity to live the American dream. But what is the American dream when it comes to a lot of the cultures that's here? Is the American dream simply to have a husband, a wife, a picket white fence around in the house with a dog and a cat? Because everybody's reality is not that. The area of District 9 where I come from in Eastdale, our American dream is just simply to survive. We're trying to maintain a single parent household. We're trying to make sure that fathers are still in the home. Incarceration rates are soaring. So the American dream is not the normal American dream what everybody else is having. So we need to make sure we're making sure everybody have that success.
The short answer is yes. And I have to think, Ms. Coonrod sort of picked my brain. Because the reality is, though we should assist persons coming into this country, and many pay taxes and all the other things that the rest of us do, in doing so, at times, we forget about those who have already been here, who have paid taxes, and there is still that mindset of some people that those out of sight, out of mind. If we focus totally on being a sanctuary city, what do we do about the people who are already here? I feel part of our problem in the past here, when we talk about gangs and shootings and so forth, is because administration after administration has said, oh, we don't have a gang problem. And now it's festered to the point where, you know, we have to deal with it. Now, I have to say about the present administration, it's made efforts. Everything hasn't worked, nothing always, everything can work about it. But they've been willing to make changes to the plan to put in more technology, more community involvement, things of this nature. So basically what I'm saying is, let us not get on our horse and say sanctuary city and forget about those who are already in need of transformation. And my jobs plan would go a long way to deal with that. Thank you.
We have a president in office right now who is betraying foundational American values on this issue. And in doing so, the response from our migrant communities is one of fear, and rightfully so. This is a tragedy. ICE would support anything that our city can legally do to support these communities, because our neighborhoods have to be places of belonging for everyone. Thank you.
Yes, I do agree. I would like to just ask the question myself. How many people in the audience agree that we should be a sanctuary city? If you wanna raise your hand. See, a lot of times as these debates go on, we know the answers to give you. Don't be fooled, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of people are going to tell you what you want to hear because they know that's what you want to hear. And then come March the 7th, we're going to do something totally different. You understand? So I'm pretty sure you're not getting fooled right now. So you do understand that. A while back, my forefathers needed sanctuary. My grandparents, my grandmother, you know, a lot of you in here living your life today needs sanctuary. So how can you not want that for your people? We are here to serve, like I said, a long time ago when we started this forum. So please, y'all, serve your community, serve your people. And if we serve, I think things will be a lot better. Thank you.
Yeah. You know, I guess for about 20 years, we've had a steady migration of Latin American people who've been migrating to our community. It would give you some sense that they felt that we were a sanctuary city, particularly those who come from Guatemala. They've set up a lot of businesses and shops in our neighborhood, in my district particularly. I think in District 8, they're quite friendly as far as doing business. Some of them are afraid. Their children, even in schools such as Eastside, they don't want their children to get involved in extracurricular activities, such as playing soccer on the soccer fields, volunteering for things like that. They don't want to get exposed in any way, and they work at our plants down on 11th Street and also on the east side. So the need is great for us to do what we can to protect them in any way we can, and to, as a city, protect them as much as we can. And we do encourage a lot of organizations to work with them throughout the community, and we patronize them to support their businesses so they can make a living, and we do other things in their behalf. The city should do what it can for us to be an official sanctuary city. Thank you.
I agree with Moses. For everything except that, it's been 800 years. A little history. It's 800 years that Mexicans and Guatemalans have been coming, and it was 800 years ago that Mexicans transformed Chattanooga from, at the place of Citico, from hunter-gatherer woodland civilization to the Mississippian civilization of the Muscogee and the Yuchi. These are words that the city has long forgotten. Chattanooga is a Muscogee term, and it was a sanctuary city 800 years ago for Hispanics, well, before Spanish, excuse me, with native languages coming up the Mississippi River, going up the Tennessee River, forming, planting corn here. It was corn planted on the Tennessee River that made Chattanooga, a sanctuary city. So today you get to see it only in these two neighborhoods. The remnants, or the still alive culture in the milpas, the cornfields that people still plant in these communities here. Have you seen them? The cornfields out there? Call them by their name, milpas. They were here 800 years ago. It transformed Chattanooga. And yes, we should be a sanctuary city. I believe we are a sanctuary city. And it starts right here. This is the most diverse section of Chattanooga in anywhere, in any place in Chattanooga, in Hamilton County. Thank you.
So I mentioned earlier that my grandfather came to Highland Park. He came here to escape religious persecution and to build a better life for him and his family right here in the United States of America. And forever else, forget my life out of it, the people who came alongside him here, they also benefited their country as they worked hard to build a better life. And that's really what we're talking about. So as we look at the values that seem to be eroding every day, it's important for the city to examine our own practices. And let's be specific about what those are. When we talk about sanctuary city, what we're really talking about particularly is whether law enforcement is asking questions of people when they pull them over about their immigration status. And our policy is that we don't. And so anybody who knows Chief Fletcher and has talked to him for more than 30 seconds knows that he is not going to do that, because he considers that profiling, which is our position as well. We cannot do that. More than that, we need to make sure that people feel included in our city. That's why we funded the first family resource center at La Paz that connects up people to their opportunities. That's why we funded for the first time Bridges to Community over at Chattanooga State, so that more people can learn English to participate in our economy here. One of the most moving moments of the time that I've been mayor was at that Bridges to Communities program, and hearing someone from the Sudan talking about how learning English had changed her life and how she truly felt part of the United States of America.
Uh, I think all that the mayor just said is good, because, and it did not start in his administration. It started a long time ago. Because the people, the immigrants, were coming into town, and we had gangsters kicking down doors where people lived, sometimes multiple families, and they wouldn't report it because they didn't want to be thrown out of the country. So they were easy targets for the gangs. So we made sure that they knew to report it, and to we would protect them, and they would not be turned over to ICE. That's been going on for a long time in Chattanooga. We have made that a purpose. I don't know that making a declarative sentence to draw attention to it by declaring that we are something. It's what we do. That's what we've been doing. And we've tried to integrate them into our church. We've tried to have proper police practices. And the last thing is, when you see Guatemalans forming city business districts and shopping with each other, that's a lesson for the black community. I will work to create a black business district. Guatemalans shop with Guatemalans, Koreans shop with Koreans, and there's nothing wrong, as Mr. Anderson said, that to have a black business district, and I'm gonna institute one.
This will be our last question, and this question is actually for District 8 candidates. The question is, can you give an example of bad development in Chattanooga and explain what the phrase equitable development means to you?
Repeat the question, please.
Sure. Can you give an example of bad development in Chattanooga and explain what the phrase equitable development means to you?
I guess a bad development, housing development, would have been the old City Cope projects, where it had one way in and no way out. But, you know, the same way in and out, with a lot of housing, and therefore, and the streets were so narrow that the police department couldn't get in and out. That would have been what I would consider a bad development. Equitable development would be a development where all businesses would have an equal opportunity. There would be a diverse type of businesses that would be available within that development. That would be housing, it would be commercial, it would be rental, and the like. Thank you.
Bad development. When you look at a lot of the projects in housing developments, you got over 500 people living in some places call it a concrete jungle. You got criminals, rapists, gangbangers, grandmothers, hardworking people living in these areas, and they're all classified as one group of people, all classified as thugs and people that are less fortunate, when a lot of these people just want a hand up, not a handout. And so a lot of them walk around with guns or whatever, not because they want to be gangbangers, because they want to protect themselves. We need to think about that. So when more project developments is bad development to me. If we build things in these communities, safe havens, where young kids can go get educated, where young people can go thrive and learn trades and learn how to make a better life for themselves, I think that would be awesome development. Another bad development is another condo downtown that's not getting rented out or just sitting there, because we've gave these people so many tax breaks and they just popping up these condos everywhere that we can't afford. I think that's bad development. And I also think that if we start to invest in the people in these communities that we consider bad areas, we will see an awesome return and an awesome development come out of those communities. Thank you.
Bad development, I think, is what's happening over in North Central Avenue Extension, and that is the putting Central Avenue through the Lincoln Park neighborhood, through Lincoln Park, over trying to put it underneath the railroad, then to come up and make a luxury apartment complex, luxury, high-end, over on the old Brownfield site above Citico Creek, and then to put University Housing Group on the old Citico site. There are 188 burials that were taken from there. There are probably over double that amount still there. That would be a bad development. Other bad developments, I agree with Anthony, that housing people in concentrated numbers is a bad idea. Bad development also is when there's no development in Oak Grove, when there is good development happening right here in District 9 with the conversion of these factory sites. And equitable development would be spreading the development around town. One of the things that confuses me as far as bad development goes is how are all the hotels downtown funded when there isn't enough business to keep the Chattanoogan itself going? To me, that's a question of bad development. Also, when we are giving away tax breaks in the pilots program, losing $35 million and not getting it back to fund our schools, that's a bad thing. Or not schools, our other infrastructure. That's a bad development. Thank you.
Is there anyone else here that would like to answer that question? Do we do have time for you to do
so? I agree with that one, Tom. We're not known developed Citico site, I will tell you that. Second, the Chattanooga, and I raised the money for that and started the whole Southside project. But the next administration that took over changed that and built the Chattanooga, which was not in the plan, and it had no strategic value to Chattanooga, and it has been a money drain on the city of Chattanooga. So that is by far, it makes me almost cry when I look at it, because we had such high hopes for economic development had it been done according to the plan. The projects, obviously, that was a bad design. We'll never do anything like that again in Chattanooga or anywhere, I hope, in the country. We've got some innovative ideas to do infill development, one at a time, with developers that typically would not develop in the city. We're going to raise up developers to develop these lots one at a time. Most home builders won't touch it, but we're going to do that.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, I have a radio show that I'm paying for, so I'm going to have to leave. I just want you to know I'm just not just walking out on you, okay? All right. But I did want to say to you, things I say to you about what has been accomplished in District 9, fact check me. Don't just take my word for it. And I'm saying to you that we will continue that progress in District 9 if we all work together. That's the basis. Working together works. And workforce development, I feel, will transform this community. Now, just as I say to you, fact check me, fact check my opponents also, okay? And I'm saying that at the end of the day, you will come to the conclusion that the service you have now from Councilperson Hakeem in District 9 is what you need going forward, because I have relationships that get things done. Thank you.
We will allow you 30 seconds for a closing statement for each candidate.
My name is Pat Benson Jr. And I'm running, you want to know why I'm running for Chattanooga City Council? Because of Bianca Horton, Apprentice Barry, Ashley McKenzie, and the 19 other homicide victims that have taken place over the past 3 years. These aren't political issues, these are moral issues. Who are we as a community? Are we okay with these sort of statistics, or do we want change? And if you want change, you need to vote Pat Benson Jr. on March 7th for City Council District 9. I'm gonna work just as hard as you do every single day at your job, and I cannot be outworked. I've got a backbone made out of steel, I wear my heart on my sleeve, and you're always gonna know where I'm coming from.
Thank you.
I'm going to use my seconds to rebuttal. My opponent has told you some untrue information, and we need to get it right before we leave today. My opponent here has stated he's provided 89 jobs to people within that district, and he's the only one. Absolutely not true. Current administration, including myself, we've had opportunities and still do today, moving forward, provide jobs. I am a franchise owner of JanPro. Every job that I've given to 20 people comes directly from District 9. Those jobs are from people that have background issues, they're disadvantaged, marginalized, not the typical pick of the litter. We have partnerships with Orange Grove, MSI, Aerotech. If you fill out your application and you let them know immediately that you come from the Eastdale community, you're guaranteed to be moved at the top of the application pool. So those are the things that we're getting done in District 9. I most definitely was on the ground running for Ban the Box, working with the current administration, the Wilcox Tunnel, advocating for restoring rights of convicted felons, and so much more. So please cast your vote for Demetrius Coonrod. We still have work to do, and it's gonna take all of us. But please do not get hoodwinked by these business concepts that's not gonna work for everybody in District 9. It's time to improve the lives in District 9 so we all can begin to thrive.
The city of Chattanooga doesn't do a good enough job of meeting people where they are. We have to prioritize place. We have to prioritize people. That's how you close Chattanooga's opportunity gaps. We have to go into districts 8 and 9 and prioritize our neighborhoods for job creation, for promoting entrepreneurship, for truly affordable housing, for vocational training opportunities, for capital spending. For the last 4 years, the lion's share of capital spending has taken place in District 7. It's time that we reorder our priorities in Chattanooga and turn our focus inward into the inner city neighborhoods. 9. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Anthony Bird. I'm running for District 8. And after March the 7th, I would love to serve this community with all my heart. I want to invest in the people of the community. I want to be at your doorstep. I want to be at your homes talking to you daily. After March the 7th, your vote, are you going to be as popular as you are today? Think about that. Think about it. Remember what happened in 2013. We have a lot of problems in Chattanooga. I can't fix them myself, but together as a community, we can fix them, and I'm ready to do that. Thank you so much.
My name is Moses Freeman. I've been a hardworking city councilman for the last 4 years of my term. Elect me again and I'll work just as hard for you as I worked the first 4 years. Thank you very much for your time.
I got in this fight to save Citico and to save Lincoln Park from development. I'm now in this fight to make sure that there is equity in our relationships across the city and that we get a disparity report that tells us exactly how things are going, especially since we lost the Ox Center for Metropolitan Studies 5 years ago. My name is Tom Kunish. I'm running for Council District 8. I appreciate your vote. Thank you.
It's been an incredible privilege to serve y'all over the last 4 years. And we've seen progress. A lot more to do. Not everything is done. But what has inspired me in this race is to both see the amazing things that everybody in Chattanooga, not just government, but organizations, churches, nonprofits, private businesses have done over the last 4 years, and to know that we can do more, that progress is possible. I also know that progress can be lost, and we certainly know that better today than we ever have before. we don't elect leadership, that's going to move us forward. So I'm Andy Burke. Early voting has started, and I ask for your vote. Thank you very much.
If you believe these are little problems and can be solved with words and politics, don't vote for me. Vote for my opponents. If you think they're big challenges and need big programs, you better vote with somebody that's done big things before. And I'm the only one in this race who has. It's going to take $500 million in the neighborhoods to fix these problems. I know how to raise it. I will do it. It's my number one priority. I ask for your vote. I'm David Crockett.
I really appreciate you all's time. Thank you for the community coming out, all your great questions. Maybe some will stay around if you want to continue to meet and greet and ask the questions on a personal level, then please do so. If you can give us 1 minute for a small announcement.
Hello, good to see a good turnout. My name is Dwight Smith. I'm the political action chairman at the NAACP office. Downtown 756 MLK, right down the street from Olivet Baptist Church. We have this very same forum that will be going on at 1 o'clock from 1 to 3 at the NAACP office. We ask you guys to continue what you're doing. Come on down to the NAACP office and let's have one-on-one conversation with these ladies and gentlemen about what they would do to help your community. Thank you.
Thanks again, everybody, for coming out this morning. A big round of applause for our hardworking candidates. Don't forget to vote. Thank you.
Thank you.